Good evening, everyone.
Now they're looking at some
development. The Strategy, Planning and Partnerships Committee and the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee public meeting will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside Australia. Welcome everyone to the Strategy, Planning and Partnerships Committee, Tuesday the 3rd of May. The Strategy, Planning and Partnerships Committee acknowledges that we are meeting in the traditional, on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge their continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Apologies and leave of absence. I have on leave Councillor Clarahan. Do we have any other apologies? There are a couple of members missing, maybe on their way. Okay. Members, I'll call for confirmation of minutes from the 5th of April. Can I have someone move? Lord Mayor, may I have a second, please? Councillor Antic. Members, I'll put that. All those in favour, declare those minutes carried. Thank you. Members, we have no public forum this evening. And I have no verbal report except to just welcome one of our new directors. So welcome to your first, is this your first committee meeting in the Kaurna Lightroom? So welcome, thank you. Members, I've called for items for adoption on block. Now, just to advise, item number 7 is a presentation. I'm pulling out item number 8 for anyone to ask any questions of administration. And I'm also pulling out item number 9, again, for a very brief overview. But members, I'll now, and I just note that item number 12 is withdrawn from this evening's agenda. So if you could note that, please. So members, I'm going to item number 10 now. Anyone want to withdraw this item? Item number 11.
Yes, ma'am.
Deputy Lord Mayor. And that is all. So I'll call for a mover for item number 10. Councillor Abiyat, seconder, please. Lord Mayor. Anyone, I'll put that. All those in favour, declare item number 10 carried. Members, I now move to item number 7, which is a presentation regarding Adelaide Oval number 2, the pathway. I welcome some guests that we have who are joining us this evening. We have Tommy Pavick, the Chief Financial Officer from the Stadium Management Authority, Ben Champion, Project Manager, Department of Planning, Transport and Infrastructure, and Alex Gain, Landscape Architect with Oxygen. Welcome. Have I missed anyone? Have I got that covered correctly?
No, that's great.
Thank you. So what we'll do is we'll start your presentation and then do you want to leave questions till the end? Is that how you want to do it? Okay, I'm handing over to Alex, is that right? All right. You just pop the speak button on, the red.
Thank you.
Over to you.
So we'll be really brief tonight. We've just got a couple of slides clarifying a few of the items from last time we came to council. So, the first one is, I guess, the future intentions, and this is around Oval number 2 and Adelaide Oval. So I guess clarification was requested on what are the future intentions. So I'll pass over to Ben to explain further.
Yep, thanks for the opportunity to come and explain what it is that we're doing at the moment with Adelaide Oval number 2. This is the last package of works that we're delivering at Adelaide Oval out of $12 million of Commonwealth funding that we had made available for the Adelaide Oval Greater Precinct, called the Northern Riverbank Precinct. This package of works, it will exceed the amount of budget that we have available. So in terms of future works, the funding we have available is expended, and we aren't planning any more future works beyond these packages of works that are happening at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Just to clarify, in terms of the oval itself and its use, the oval will be used for a number of different purposes. It's been upgraded to a first-class cricket standard. It will be used for more minor cricket matches, future league, etc. Tommy, Scorpions, and it relieves some of the pressure off of Adelaide Oval itself for those cricket matches. It also gets used for practice for cricket and practice for the football teams that use the oval. It also gets used for car parking during events, and essentially that's the department's plans for the future and the Stadium Management Authority's plans for the future for the Adelaide Oval number 2 and the precincts surrounding Adelaide Oval number 2.
If we could just flick through, so we've covered off that one. The next item was, I guess, the oval number 2 path. Now, we're not looking for a resolution tonight in that we're still undertaking, I guess, some further investigations, and that'll be confirmed in a subsequent letter. But just to run through where we're at with this oval number 2 path. So this diagram just establishes that we are really looking at a path which takes pedestrians, cyclists, and the wicket transporter as a main mover of the transportable wickets from the nursery to the main oval. Next slide. Just a diagram so I guess everyone can clearly see what are the precinct materials. So I guess we have the exposed aggregate concrete around the south plaza and the east plaza and the concourse, and as we move around to the north there is a greater amount of hot mix, but we can provide this diagram at a later stage for people to review. So the next one. So the main path users are the pedestrian cyclists. There's a photo of the wicket transporter there, and then the match day cars. Next one. So these are the four materials that we've gone away and explored. So I guess we have the existing compacted rubble. Now we do have some issues with this, with the wear and tear, especially taking the 60-ton wicket transporter. And the team's preference is for a sealed path for not just the wicket transporter, but pedestrians and cyclists. So the SMA already had a number of complaints from an access point of view, especially during winter. Then we've explored the hot mix, and that was in the current budget allowance. Then we have the exposed aggregate concrete, and then the clear binder asphalt. Just to give you a rough idea of costs, and these aren't fixed, but the clear binder asphalt was coming in at around 400,000 to 500,000, which this is due because it's a very small section of path and they have to shut down the entire bitumen plant for one day. So although we really like the idea, I think it's only viable in bigger areas like the parade grounds, where you can actually have enough metres squared to justify it. The concrete was then coming in at around 200,000. The hot mix is about 100,000. And then the compacted rubble is around about 70,000, but with ongoing maintenance costs, probably on a yearly or two yearly basis. So we haven't put forward our final position, and that'll happen in a subsequent letter, but that's to just explain where we are at with the analysis.
And I think that's it for the presentation, and more than happy to take any questions that anyone has.
Yeah, thank you for your presentation. I'm sure if we could just leave that slide up, because I'm sure that is probably where most of the questions might come from. And I know that you said that you haven't made a final decision yet. But I'll go, Councillor Vishal.
Thanks. Through the chair, if I could ask, if we could just go back to the one next one.
Yeah.
So the hot mix.
Yes.
What size is that area? It looks huge from here.
Oh, so the red area is the new hot mix.
Yeah.
And then the orange is the existing that's already down.
And that was the one that was really wide enough for the
It's 4 metres wide, yeah, and that's only, well, one is, so we've got a shared use path, but really the wicket transporter needs about 3.6 metres and then a little bit to wiggle either side.
It's narrower than the Pennington Lane that already comes.
That's right.
So it's not.
It had to be 4 metres for the.
Yeah, for the wicket transporter, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So members, you'll recall we had this discussion on, in the council chamber, I think Deputy Lord Mayor, you moved particularly around the makeup of the pathway, if I'm correct, is that right? Any other questions, members? Is that a question, Councillor Wilkinson? We'll come to that.
The car park there, that's hot mix, that's already sealed?
That's right.
It's only the section in red.
Yeah, I agree, yeah.
And that's what you're saying was 400,000 to 500,000 in the clear go-charge program?
Yes, we've asked.
200,000 for the concrete?
Yes.
How much for the hot mix?
100,000.
And then 70 for the gravel?
Yeah, that's right.
You got us a deal, Sandy?
Well, we're considering looking at this clear asphalt as a general parkland material. And I understand, I've spoken to Paul about this, and the reason why there's this exorbitant cost is because they're not using it all the time.
That's right.
But, I mean, I'm looking, we're reviewing our general public realm documents, including parkland cars. And one of the things we're seriously going to be looking at is having that as our standard, such that if that became our standard, then the cost of that, if we could be laying this on an ongoing basis, then that might.
Well, most certainly.
Be cheaper, because we didn't want to have a black bitumen road, it was rather just the unsealed path.
We certainly understand that it was just that we were surprised at how expensive it was for a one-off thing, and then to give the SMA an asset, which if, say, the wicket transporter damaged the path, you couldn't readily available, a material that would patch it.
Yeah, the other issue is, patching it, because you wouldn't have clear binder asphalt available in very small quantities to do patching and maintenance type activities. So, I guess that's something maybe to consider ongoing as well.
Unless we were using it on.
Even then, for very small ad hoc, for any maintenance uses, would be a very difficult product to use. So the likelihood is it would get patched with other materials, which doesn't, then compromises the look of it long term.
Can you turn your mic off?
Well, I think that's something that we should be looking at, is that, so.
I think we'll take that up in another forum, Councillor Wilkinson. So we've got Councillor, Deputy Lord Mayor and Councillor Martin, and then we'll, got a question, Deputy Lord Mayor?
Yeah, well, I don't really understand the purpose of this presentation. Is it to ask our opinion? Is it to, tell us, because you, I mean, the way that you're approaching it is really, I mean, you actually just call it that hot mix path. So, you appear to be pushing us or identifying that as the most realistic option?
I think what we're trying to point out is having an unsealed path does require a lot of maintenance and potentially result in a lot of complaints from the public who use the oval for parking during winter. It also, I know from discussions with the SMA, they do have to undertake quite regular maintenance on that path to use their beach transporter and other vehicles and things while they're doing maintenance work on the oval and the surrounds. So having an unsealed path, although it does have some advantages in terms of the look, it has quite distinct disadvantages for the end user, which is the Stadium Management Authority. So I think we wanted to point out that not having it sealed, we see as quite a big risk for ongoing costs and ongoing complaints. And then we looked at various sealing options, and I guess we just wanted to point out that we haven't decided we would prefer to have it sealed. That's our position. But as we explored the sealing, different sealing options, we discovered some quite serious cost implications and implications for those different various methods of sealing the path. and we thought it was a good opportunity to highlight to council our preference to seal the path and then the different options and those different issues that surround those different options.
So my question is, are you here to make a recommendation, and what's the where to from here?
Where to from here? Council has written to the department saying that they would prefer an unsealed path. That was part of the letter that came to us. We will finish our investigation of these options and consideration of where we stand, and we'll write in response. We had organised to come and, before we got that letter, organised to come and present to council to go through these options, but we're now looking to write a letter in response to outline what our preference is from there.
So members, and maybe that's a question we'll ask our admin as well from our side in terms of next steps.
We could just go back to the other slide, which shows the various services.
Yep.
It's a subsidiary question, really. See the car parking area on the north, the actual, not the parklands that's used as car parks, but the actual car parking area.
Yep.
Is that used daily?
There are car parks there daily. I've been there on weekdays when no events are on, and it is used by a small amount of vehicles. I wouldn't say there's a lot of vehicles there on normal days, but Tommy, you're there every day.
Certainly it's available for use and function in events, clients, particularly an event that's been hosted in the Rockland Room, for example, patrons will park in that north half stand area. And that's the nearest entry point. We walk into the north gate, in the hot room or any other area within the island.
Do staff use it?
I have seen maintenance vehicles from time to time parked there, but typically the staff will park in the east car park.
The east car park?
Which is an underground.
The underground, the Wilson car park.
Yes, correct.
Okay. Well, thank you for your presentation.
Just in answer to a question, Deputy Lord Mayor, on what are the next steps in terms of communication, I might just get Adrian Stokes to give some response.
Yeah, through the Chair, and just to clarify as well that the purpose for tonight's briefing, the resolution of Council from a couple of months ago in relation to the path was requesting that it not be sealed, and that we would be exploring options with the designers and the SMA and DIPTI, so that is an ongoing process. The other resolution was that DIPTI and the SMA be asked for an update on the future intentions for the Oval, so that was the primary reason for inviting them in today, was to provide that update, and that was why we made that the first part of the presentation. So the primary purpose was to round back on that decision of Council, and also to give you some feedback about where the discussions are with the path, and so we'll continue to have those conversations, and we'll get back to council about that at a later date.
Thank you. I've got Councillor Martin, then Councillor Moran.
Hi, thank you. The proposed pathway isn't really what it was, is it, in the sense that you've got to actually go through the car park now to get onto the pathway to get out where there are other routes. So it would seem to me that the primary purpose is to have a pathway that is going to be able to handle traffic from the car park, as well as, of course, the wicket transporter. My concern, quite separately from whatever's been discussed about the surface, is the access onto Monte Fiore Hill, or the bottom of it, out onto the roadway, and at the moment there is no specific provision for cars to leave in a safe manner. Is it your intention to create some kind of safe left turning or exit into the street?
I guess what we're doing, the cars have been using the Oval to park during football and cricket events for the last couple of years, and what we're doing doesn't change that in any way. The access arrangement on Monte Fiore won't be altered through that. I'm not specifically sure what police involvement there is during actual event days. I don't know, Tommy, whether you can discuss, because usually there's a traffic management, as in they will stop through traffic and allow vehicles out. During non-game days, that entrance is blocked, it's got bollards and is locked and is not accessible. So the other car park area, which is in the orange, is accessed purely from Pennington Lane, and there's no vehicles accessing through at other times. I don't think that you don't use it regularly for maintenance. It might be occasionally for maintenance, vehicles, etc. So it would only be during event days that there's any particular cars.
Yeah. I think maybe we could get some more information on that, take that on notice and get you some more information, Councillor Martin, on that. Councillor Moran?
Yes, why? So the red light over oval two car, that's going to be hot. You'd like that to be hot.
We'd like it to be sealed.
Okay. So it should be the orange hot mix colour? Red
to show that that's what we're discussing today.
We want it sealed. We haven't actually specifically said it has to be hot mix. Look, there are issues with all those different types of services. So hot mix is a possibility.
If it was, as a maintenance for the clear...
Councillor Moran, use your microphone.
The clear thing was solved, would it then, you still couldn't do it because it was prohibitively expensive? I know you had that both on the right hand side. Is that the deal breaker or is it the upkeep on the clear?
The clear binder, it's both, the upkeep and the initial costs. An initial cost, the fact that to produce it, they lose a whole day's production for their plant. So that's why it's really, really
it's
expensive.
It's just because parade ground's been there for, 10 years now, and that's had tanks, heavy military vehicles, and I look across there every day and I've never seen a patch or cracked or damaged in any way. So it has held up very well.
Yeah, you know, generally it will...
That would be the idea.
It would last you generally.
You go down and inspect it often, Councillor.
I do. I walk across the every day, and they have the really big tanks and the cranes that have put the the train things onto the festival and it should be contained. So and it really just hasn't damaged it at all.
The difference with this location is because it's adjacent to irrigated oval, and parkland's very close, right up to the edge of it. It does have the potential for the water to get in under the pavement. It also has a distinct edge where tyres for the vehicle will drive close to that edge, and that tends to break the edges off. So it's a slightly different arrangement to the same parade.
What about the sort of lesser but slightly less stark red bitumen that we've put on we're supposed to put on all parkland cars and we put on some parkland cars?
Yeah, so
would that be a bit soft?
Yeah, Alex might be able to talk about
that. We certainly discussed that with council staff, and their understanding was that was only for parklands trail and not for other parklands paths.
We don't own the patent on red bitumen.
No, but
many would consider that a parkland path.
Oh, so it was like the designated parklands trail. So.
Right. No. I moved that motion. It was never meant to be any park. But I wonder why they weren't.
We'll take up that issue later, Councillor Moran.
But could we consider now, having cleared that up, that it's supposed to be on all parkland paths? Could that be considered as a better alternative than black concrete?
I think we could discuss it. We'd probably need to discuss it with the council staff a lot more and go through that option, but I'm certainly not against it.
Well, it looked better than black, didn't it, anyway? Yeah, that's what we want, something that doesn't look like black pictures.
Yep. All right, that can be taken on notice. All right, I'm going to wind up this presentation. So thank you very much for your time, and thanks for the presentation and the information, and look forward to hearing back from you for our council administration. Members, move to item number 8. I'll invite Kylie Bennett to join us. Hi, Kylie. Members, what ultimately I want to do on this is didn't want to have a large presentation on the feedback received in the strategic plan, more really wanted to give you the opportunity to ask any questions that you had on a specific line item. So I'll open that up for questions and we'll go from there. Anyone have any specific questions? Councillor Martin.
Chair, I appreciate your desire to limit discussion on this, but there are significant alterations to the strategic plan throughout all of the accompanying documents
over some 10 pages. And some of the alterations.
So this is not alterations, Councillor Martin, this is just the feedback for you to note and to identify if you do want to do more with this information.
Well, perhaps you could clarify for me, Chair, the third column on each of these strategic plan pages says admin proposal for final plan. Does that mean that that's just accepted, or is that a proposal for us to discuss?
No, it doesn't mean it's accepted, because we are going to endorse the strategic plan, but maybe I'll just get Kylie to clarify that column for you.
Sure. So through the chair, what we were hoping to achieve through this workshop was to focus on the feedback that we've received from the community where they may have suggested a material or a substantive change. So at the special council meeting a couple of weeks ago, you considered the entirety of the strategic plan feedback, and you also received some submissions from the public. We're intending or hopeful that we'll take the strategic plan to council later in the month for your endorsement, and at that meeting we'll give a summary of the positive support that was received for the strategic plan, as well as the partners that have indicated their support in working with council on implementing your strategic plan once endorsed. So what you have before you are what admin considered to be perhaps more substantial changes to the plan, and we wanted to focus in on that with you tonight. The admin proposal for final plan is merely a proposal for your consideration and discussion, and that's been based on a workshop with the executive leadership group and technical staff within the team. So as a workshop, we're really seeking your feedback and guidance on what you'd like to see in your final plan.
So members, this item is not decision making. Obviously the strategic plan is going to come back, but what the administration would like you to do is, if anything that jumps out at you from this document or from the feedback received, to flag it now, because then we can have that discussion as part of the strategic planning process before it comes back to this or committee or council.
Okay, yeah, well that's what I thought was being proposed, and yes, I do have some comments for the administration in regard to the document that's before us.
So can you highlight what number you're talking
about? Yes, certainly. I'll go through them, numbering each one. At S2, I'm proposing that the administration, as it has done at various other places, proposing that matters should have a finish date, suggest that during the 2017-18 financial year should read that is by the end of June 2018.
Did you say, what number
did you say? S2. Yes, sorry. And that's reflected too in G3. Where there is on page 15 a number of people asking for time frames for the administration, and I think the administration...
Is that a more general comment you're making?
No, it's a specific comment. I'd like to see that firm date.
Could you just make that point again, because it doesn't read to
me. Yeah, sure, yeah. Sure. In the original strategic plan, we said by the end of 2017, it is suggested that be altered to the end of 2018. I'm suggesting let's be more specific than that and make it by the end of June 2018, which is a realistic time frame, rather than just the end of 2018.
Yep.
And the administration has done that throughout the document, typing it up and making it clearer as to the dates.
Yeah, that's fine. Yep.
I want to also echo the concerns of Business SA, which is asking at G3 for us to consider how additional costs associated with carbon neutrality will be managed and shared. That's a reasonable question, and I'm not sure that the current draft, as is suggested by the administration, adequately reflects that. I want to also highlight S8, where the restaurant and catering organisation is testing our assertions it's saying that you have enough businesses in the city at this time. You shouldn't be expanding the capacity as we are within our guidelines until you're sure that there is the demand. And essentially they're highlighting that while we expect businesses to grow by 300, the number of people coming into the city is going to be something like 6,000, and that works out to about 20 people per business. And that's their argument. It's not sustainable. And I just ask the administration to consider that. G16, Renewal SA has proposed the development of the Torrens River. And let me read it to you. While Torrens River does contribute to calm and serenity, also wanted to be redeveloped as a vital and iconic precinct featuring space amenities, experiences of a world-class design that buzz with people and events of day and night. That wasn't accompanied by any kind of physical presentation on the night, it was merely in the papers. And it's suggested by the administration to edit the text to the green theme to describe the Torrens River in this way. Now, the Torrens River is a mighty river, and so far as the Adelaide City Council is concerned, it runs from Hackney Road. Well, I'm not talking about hollows, I'm talking about the length. It runs from the Hackney River over to the brewery. Now, that kind of renewal SA proposal to have something as broad as that is not in the interests of our ratepayers, in my view. And if it is that we are talking about the precinct that is delineated by the Morford Bridge and the Kingsland Road Bridge, then that's fine, I understand that, but that's not what's inferred in that.
I think, Councillor Martin, that's relating to Riverbank Precinct, and I think we should take that feedback on.
Yep, and that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, through the chair, we'll take that on notice and look at it before the next draft. It's
probably, yeah, okay. I think we could safely say that will be Riverbank Precinct.
Okay. Additionally, at L4, we're proposing to take up the proposal of the administration, in fact, it's proposed by the administration, to encourage the state government to improve public transport, to promote greater patronage, including continued investment and expansion of the Free City Connector services. Now, we discussed that here at the council in a budget meeting, and it was agreed that we would not proceed with that. Therefore, it's something of a contradiction that it should appear in this document, and I'd ask that that be reassessed in the context of the budget.
Albeit, we can always encourage the state government to, if I look at those words, to improve. The key words in that sentence.
So long as we're agreed that the expense goes to the state government, I'm happy to look at anything. Renewal SA is, again, accepted at face value. It's addressing housing affordability, L14. And Chair, I know that you and I have differing opinions on this, but this is a slight alteration to the strategic plan. And what it suggests that we need to address housing and affordability, including diversity of dwelling stock, and deliver a range of initiatives such as adaptive building reuse and new building technologies. Now, it's not saying that we need to highlight those and encourage people, it's saying that we need to deliver initiatives. And I don't remember that we've had a discussion about that. I have a view about affordable housing projects. This one goes a step further, and Renewal SA is proposing the nature of the housing affordability projects that we should endorse.
Well, I think it says, Councillor, deliver a range of initiatives such as adaptive building reuse and new building technologies. I think it's just using them as.
Well, it's in the context example. Of developing, and the context is important, Chair.
I don't think it says developing at all.
Yeah. It does.
It says deliver a range of initiatives.
Correct.
Well, such as adaptive building reuse and new building technology.
Well, are we going to put out a booklet or adapt a building? If we're going to adapt a building, then that's an initiative that amounts to something more concrete than a description of, you know, encouraging the practice.
We can just tweak the words on it.
I have a matter that I want to raise in respect of L21. The draft parklands management strategy is given voice here. It's proposed internally that we provide activity hubs in the parklands for informal recreation, including skate and cycling opportunities, and support the enhancement of the existing sports infrastructure to to ensure they're accessible to all. Now, those are the words from the draft Parklands Management Strategy, which has not yet been through APLA, and it may well be endorsed, by the way, by APLA and Council, but it seems to me to have anticipated the vote of APLA and the Adelaide City Council and incorporated in the strategic plan to go to Council for endorsement before the other matters have been canvassed is, anticipating too much. And moreover, that same confidence continues. If you turn to page 15, you'll find a submission from the Adelaide Cemeteries Authority, which it's proposed that we also incorporate, requesting more space be made available through the parklands on West Terrace for more graves. That's right, more graves on West Terrace. Our proposal on page 15 reads...
Could you give me the number again?
Yeah, sure. Look, I know I've got new glasses, but I can't read that page number. Is that 15, Councillor Moran?
15, yep.
Okay. If you go down to G14, Adelaide Cemeteries Authority considers the future need for cemetery space should be recognised in the plan. And our administration says incorporated in the current draft to be taken up as part of the Parklands Management and Tourism Action Plan. Now, that raises another issue for Councillor Moran here, and that is that the Tourism Action Plan has not been actioned. In fact, it's a thought bubble at this time. There was a very strong discussion around this table just a few nights ago in which it was proposed there should be a reduced funding allocation just because, as
they'll take that on notice and check. Let's move along so we don't, let's just give you the feedback. I'll come back to you with responses.
Okay, all right. Well, I'm happy with that, Chair. That's good. Then I wanted to go to C7, which is a laudable proposal. That is to say that we promote our UNESCO live music accreditation to attract more opportunities for new live music venues, and by June 27th, scope the project to attract a winter festival. Now, I think that's a grand idea. I endorse that. But at other places, we're so keen to strike partnerships with other organisations, and it seems almost that we're developing that in isolation, and the words partnership or engage with would be a better approach to that.
Engage with state government, you mean?
Or whoever, there has to be a broad range of stakeholders. It would be festivals, South Australia.
Yeah.
I would like to understand why, when it was debated here at council, that sport and recreation.
What number?
C1, C13. We proposed that they would sit in the creative area, and Recreation SA has responded saying, no, don't do that. And it's proposed that it now moves into the livable area. And I just would like a brief explanation about why that happened, because it is a change from what I understood was happening.
Brief explanation.
Through the chair, my understanding was it was sitting in the draft document under the creative outcome. Feedback from council members through the budget bill for 16-17 was that council members felt better sat under the livable city outcome.
Is that just a timing thing then?
Yes, really? So we're just waiting for all the documents to catch up, but it will be sitting under the livable outcome.
So, Councillor Martin, the strategic plan would have gone out before we had the business plan and budget conversation? So it's already been changed through the business plan and budget process? The strategic plan went out to consultation where we collated this feedback before we had that discussion in the business plan and budget process.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the explanation. And at C21, I beg your pardon. Yeah, C21, we are persisting with the notion that I quote, we work with the state government on planning for the Royal Adelaide Hospital development. Now, there are many opinions around this table. For example, there is a view that residential development would be disastrous. The Lord Mayor is on record and has certainly told me personally that he would see that as a bad outcome. That is, transitioning public land to private freehold, and yet we are persisting in this declaration of loyalty to the state government to support their Royal Adelaide site development. Now, we don't know what they're going to establish. It could be an abattoir. And if we want to endorse an abattoir, and that wouldn't be a bad metaphor for what's proposed, I might add, but if we want to endorse whatever the state government is proposing, that's fine. But it seems to me that there's an enormous political downside in that, and that's something more moderate that suggests that we are going to attempt to embrace that, or you know, a qualified support would be a much better.
I think Councillor Martin, when the Lord Mayor wants to make a comment, but I think all it says is that we're going to work with the state government on whatever it is, and of course that's going to come to us for more discussion. I think we just have to have some generic words in there that would, it would be appropriate. But Lord Mayor, do you want to make a specific comment?
No, I would, thank you, Chair. I'll be very brief. I just wanted to clarify Councillor Martin's comment in regards to my own comments. And my comment, of course, was that I expressed grave reservations about freehold titling on the land of the Adelaide Hospital.
Then let's stick to the topic here. We're just taking some generic feedback on feedback given on our strategic plan. So
perhaps
we just
can be done offline when
Councillor Antic, Councillor Martin, just we're going to find line members. We're not going through this line by line. They're pulling out the exceptions. Councillor Martin, you've now been speaking for nearly 15 minutes.
Yeah,
I'm just going to give you the heads up that your other fellow members are getting restless. But continue. And I just think on that one we note that we're just saying we want to work with the state government in regards to that site. There's no endorsement implied in that statement.
Well, look, Councillor Antic, I apologise for taking up your valuable time. These are, in my view, reasonable issues to discuss. And well, no, it is a matter of whether
or not. Please stick to the topic of keep going with your numbers, Councillor Martin. What's the next one?
And I simply have one observation to make in respect of G8. On page 15, we are constantly joking around this place about whether initiatives are bold enough. There was a charming piece in the Adelaide Review about our predilection for Adelaide spin doctors to use the term bold, gold-plated it was called, and yet we have throughout this plan references to boldness. And I beg that we forget the jargon and drop that affectation in favour of something that's a bit more straightforward. And that is all. Thank you.
Okay, that can be taken on notice as well. All right, now I have Councillor Moran. Okay, Councillor Bashaw.
I agree with most of the things that Councillor Martin just said, but it is a workshop, so I thought this was our forum to actually bring these things up.
Correct.
Sorry if there was a different way we were supposed to do that. I only have a few, and that is, and I'm quite happy to do it afterwards, if that's what I was looking at C2, which is growth of festival attendances. One of the things I'd like to put in there is actually what we're trying to do is not necessarily just grow the attendance, but actually grow the length of stay. So if we can incorporate something there, so festival attendees stay longer and have a broader experience of Adelaide. I agree with Councillor Martin that I don't think it's our role to scope a project for a winter festival. And in C16, I actually prefer the original wording in the draft plan, which is where for the South Australian Tourism Commission and private sector develop visitor experience and maximise spending in the city. I'm talking as fast as I can. And the rest I'll do offline. Thank you.
So they've taken on notice. You can continue if you want, or you're happy with that. Deputy Lord Mayor.
I also agree with a number of the things that Councillor Martin raised. S6, while I support the idea of the 10 gigabyte per second capable broadband network across the city, it says here that we're going to work with key partners to deliver it, and that to me seems a little bit self-assured when we haven't got a sense of whether it's deliverable or affordable. I mean, I think we definitely want to work with, but it's just to deliver.
It's the tweaking of the words.
Tweaking of the words.
Yep.
I think in G15, I would like us to have done more by June 2017 to develop a plan. I would like us to have done something. And I'd like the plan to include, I would like personally somewhere in the plan where we actually say that this is how many trees we're going to plant every year, so that we've actually got a tree target. In addition to the other greening target, we've got a pure tree target.
So is that
G15? I don't have any problem with L21 about the providing activity hubs.
If you don't have a problem with it, let's skip it. Yep, say things to exception.
Yes, I'm sorry, but I was responding actually to a comment that another councillor made, and I just wanted to indicate to our administration that it wasn't necessarily widely held view, or, you know, completely held view. I think C7, I would like us to pull out promoting our UNESCO live music and promoting the opportunities to see live music in Adelaide is one issue. So there's one issue of promoting the opportunities, second is increasing the opportunities, and third, question mark, is the Winter Festival. They seem to me, first and foremost, what we need to do is promote what we've currently got. And I'd like that to be happening well before June 17.
Yep.
We need to be doing that as a matter of urgency, in my view. I agree with Councillor Vershaw on C16 that our original working draft was better than the one that we've tweaked.
That was facilitated. But that was my comment. All right, lovely. Thank you. Any other members? I don't think I have anyone on the list. All right, thank you. That's all been noted by the administration. Just,
Through Chair, I just want to clarify, the intention was to go to Council with a final product for you to debate and consider. Based on the comments from tonight, I don't think they're overly complex and quite easily addressed. Is there a level of comfort that we can take it straight to Council, or do you wish for it to come back to committee? The only consequence of that is a delay of a month.
From what I can sense in the room, there was relatively 99.9% consensus on most of that conversation. Can I just get an indication and smiles and nods from everyone? Correct. So the strategic plan can come to Council based on the feedback that has been taken away tonight. I think it's really important that we do acknowledge that the number of submissions that we had on the strategic plan and the feedback that we received from whether it be individuals or organisations, and that we do take that seriously and that we do read it and we do consider it. That will be incorporated into our strategic plan that will come to Council for endorsement. So a little bit of pain to get a bit of gain, I think, in that session, but thank you, everyone. Members, I just need to adjourn to Councillor Wilkinson. I'm just going to ask someone to adjourn. Councillor Abiad, Councillor Corbell, second. I put that. All those in favour?
As Chair of the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee, declare the committee open and ask for adjournment. Call for adjournment. All those in favour? Carry.
Mover and a seconder.
The Lord Mayor. Second.
Vote.
All those in favour? Opposed? Thank you. Adjourned.
Thank you. I will now reopen the Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee. And we are going to item number 9. And I'm just going to invite Colleen Atkinson. And someone else? I just Colleen. Right, welcome, Colleen. Members, we do have something to move, but she's here to answer any questions you have, and maybe just you've just got a bit of an overview after there have been some changes for us to consider.
Thank you.
Is there something that's not in the report, Chair, with all due respect?
Because Councillor Moran, I guess this has changed quite considerably through the discussion from the business plan and budget. I guess we're just giving them an opportunity. It was going to be a workshop, Councillor Moran, so I changed it from a workshop to the report. Let's just get a highlight of the changes so that we know, and then we'll be very quick. Colleen, you've got 30 seconds, go.
The Chair. Members, I do understand that this conversation on brand has been ongoing for at least a year for a number of you, if not longer. So a couple of things I'll just pull out is some of you have rightfully mentioned that branding is bigger than just a brand mark. So what this report attempts to do is just pull out the brand mark component. The rest will be addressed in the city communication strategy. What we've also done is separated the different kinds of brand that we operate under at council. So what we've said is that the corporation brand, we will just incrementally improve the use and application of that over time under business as usual. What this report really looks at is the adoption of a city brand mark that we can use specifically when we are appearing and marketing ourselves as a city. What it also talks to is recommending that the civic crest remains exactly as it is, but again, we look at tidying up the application of that. So that is my 30 seconds.
All right, thanks, Colleen, for that summary and just a bit of an update on where this is. I'm going to call for a mover, Councillor Slammer, Lord Mayor. Do you wish to speak, Councillor Slammer?
Very briefly, I will. Just to commend you on a good compromise. I know where it was not long ago, and for the budget that we put in place there, 150, I think this is a good alternative. I'm quite happy with the detail in the reports too. To you and Sean, compliments for that. I think this is good all around. It addresses the purpose, which is about marketing and communicating our brand and aligning it with the state and the purpose of internationalising. So that's a big tick in my box.
Lord Mayor is a seconder.
Thanks, Chair. The guides support the recommendation as printed. I certainly think in terms of alignment with the state brand identity, which was developed some 2 to 3 years ago, which of course Adelaide City Council played a role in terms of feeding into that. I think that has certainly been the missing piece of the puzzle in terms of us not adopting formally in any capacity the Adelaide South Australia positioning. I note though, of course, Colin, you're not asking at this point in time for us to decide upon a design in any great detail, so I'm comfortable with that because I think that we'll need to come back to members to get that design right, so that's fine. But members, I think this is something we do need to ensure that we commit this for our 16-17 year cycle, because I'd hate to see this slip for yet another year. So I think what Colleen has done in terms of addressing concerns and reservations of the members in terms of resourcing and brought this down to a much more manageable and digestible financial amount, and I think your strategy is right, so I commend it.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Bashaw.
Thank you. I just am questioning with a few things. I'm hoping that the rest of the councillors have actually seen the attachment, which we didn't go through the workshop papers, and there's one on 4.1, there's an attachment that looks at the brand mark options. My concern is that what we're doing is we're going from 2 to 3 logos. It's messy enough as it is already. We've got 2 logos out there. We're now going to add a 3rd logo to it, and I don't agree with that. I'm sorry, I just don't agree with it. Which would be quite interesting, but I would rather reduce down to 1 logo than actually have 3 logos in the marketplace. So as much as I would probably ask to defer it. If we don't have time to actually have a proper workshop today, then I'd rather defer this and look at it properly.
So can I just, first of all, just take that as a question in terms of the feedback Councillor Bashaw has given on the... Is that what you were talking about? Is that the link?
That's the link, because that word working.
Yeah. And the links that weren't working. Okay, yep. So, Councillor Shaw, can I just take that as a question, if we can clarify that, or is that... In terms of those three brands that you referred to...
It's a matter of whether the councillors have actually looked at this paper, which then gives you, we will go from two brands in the market to three brands in the market.
Can I make a suggestion
three
then?
Brand marks, three
can I make a suggestion to the mover and the seconder that we added an additional point to this this recommendation that we have a workshop? Can we do it that way?
Well, just note.
Just a bird.
Can I ask a question? Can I ask a specific question?
No, you can't.
Well, Councillor Vershaw, you asked for a workshop. Debbie Lorbeer, have you finished what you have to say?
Yes.
All right, then Debbie Lorbeer, you are next on the list. And then I've got Councillor Moran, now I've got Councillor Wilkinson and Councillor Abiad. But can I ask you a question? And then I'm going to go back to the mover to see if the mover and seconder willing to do what I just suggested.
My question is that the current, it's exactly what we're signing up to, I suppose, with the current motion, which is endorse the recommended brandmark logo options as set out below. Is that in any way endorsing that document that we saw up on the screen?
No, it isn't. That document is just some examples, and it is background reading. Yeah.
Which is why then I suggest a workshop comes as part of...
Exactly, which will be...
Councillor Moran, please. That's why I'm going to suggest we then include a workshop to discuss the detail of the execution, because if it says develop and implement. Looking at, in principle, we agree, but the detail we want to...
We don't agree. I don't want a third brand.
It's been moved and seconded. You'll have to vote against it then.
But your statement was incorrect, Chair. There is not an agreement on this. This is a waste of money and I don't...
Well, I have a mover and a seconder. Okay. So in that instance...
We hated the state brand.
I don't think that is an accurate statement, Councillor Moran.
It is totally...
Okay, I've got... Deputy Mayor, you still have the floor.
Thank you. So I want to speak. I actually do like it in principle. I don't like the specifics, but I do like it in principle. These are the reasons I like it in principle. I believe we do need to continue to use our crest where we're using it officially. I believe we don't need to necessarily change our corporation brand right now. But I do like the idea of developing an Adelaide brand, not necessarily for use by us, but for use by the convention centre and those other organisations that need a destination brand for the city. And I believe that brand ought to be just an extension, really, of the state brand. And as I understand it, that's the work you're intending to do. So it's what I would like us to do is to have a brand that lies, it's really part of the state brand suite, lays alongside the state brand suite relates specifically to the city. And then obviously we maintain our other two brands. The other thing I like about the proposal that's in front of us is that it brings real, as I understand it, one of the intentions is to bring real clarity for what is used when. And at the moment, one of the things I see is that it's a bit of a dog's breakfast, that things are used in different places. So I'd like us to get some real clarity about that. Even things as simple as our PowerPoint presentations and our report writing and everything, it seems to be branded up differently every time. So getting some consistency and some simplicity to that would also be good from my point of view. So I like the idea, but I would like us to come back and talk about it in detail so that we actually make sure that we understand what we're signing up to and that we've got some real clarity about what we're going to get.
So, Dylan, are you comfortable that the admin will take it on notice, that we'll have a further workshop to discuss this? Are you comfortable with that, or do we actually need to include that?
It's up to the administration whether they want to take it on notice. Would your intention be to bring this back for a workshop for discussion about the actual brand itself?
You are making that request. So can I have that taken on notice, if that's the request?
So are you asking if we bring back the actual brand mark for discussion at a workshop? Yes, we want to.
Thank you. All right. I've got Councillor Moran, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Abiat.
Can I just ask what we're voting on now? I mean, I was going to move a deferral.
We're voting on as moved and seconded.
Oh, well, I'll move a deferral.
I'll second that.
Right, I have an amendment from Councillor Moran to defer, and I've got a seconder in Councillor Martin. Councillor Moran, you have the floor.
Well, look, I'm not going to support this whether there's a workshop or not. I'll put it on the table, but I think that others should have a bit more information on this and discuss. I mean, I think that the idea that we had three brands now, I thought we were getting rid of our Adelaide one, you know, the A, that, and putting this there, but which I didn't support either. Look, the state brand is the state brand. We're the capital city of the state. If the convention centre wants to whack Adelaide or convention centre underneath the state brand, that's what the state brand was meant for. It was meant for these individual things to put their names underneath. We don't need to put Adelaide underneath it. We've got our own logo, we've got our own brand. We already have a brand. This sort of rather sort of cloying idea that we have to invent a brand. Adelaide is Adelaide. It has a brand, a lovely brand. It's got down to to such a cheap and cheerful amount now that that it really isn't worth doing, I don't think. We're not inventing our own brand that stands alone. We're just putting an Adelaide underneath the state brand. Nobody liked the state brand. I mean, if you all want to sit here and say that
that's where I think you should talk for yourself and not for
I am talking. At the council year, we all discussed it at length. You didn't like it, Megan.
I love it.
Well, you love it then, you love it then. We were appalled by it, so I don't think we need to. I don't have to suck up to Labor government, and I can tell the truth. Well, nobody liked the state brand. I just sit next to the poor artist on a plane to Melbourne the next day, and he was rather horrified by the negative attitude of the city council. So you may have loved it, but you were alone. So I don't like it. I don't think it's a good brand. I don't think we should adopt it. I don't think we should be spending $150,000 of rate increase on it. I think it's one of those things that should just go away. But if you want a workshop on it, I'm happy to move that.
Members, we are just talking to the deferral now. Do I have anyone who specifically wants to talk to deferral? Can I go to a vote on that?
No. I would like to speak to that as the seconder if I'm entitled.
Go on.
Yep. Thank you, Chair. Look, I wanted to make the point that I am very surprised that we're having this discussion so soon after the budget debate, in which it was made clear that the expenditure of this money on branding was not something for which council had an appetite. Now it's come back to us in a different form with a different price tag of $150,000.
I think that was the discussion, Councillor Martin, for them to go away and do that. That's why this has come back.
Well, I don't think I was part of that discussion because that was not the view that I'd formed after that, but I'll accept that it's possible that others may have different interpretations of what happened.
I think that was noted in there when we did that it was to come back for reconsideration.
I want to make it clear that I want a deferral, and I want that deferral to lead to a discussion generally about the subject, not just about specifically what it looks like and how it works. The point that is raised here about having multiple brands for multiple occasions goes against everything that I learned in media. And in media, it's clear the message needs to be succinct, not confused. You never see Channel 9 saying, this is a program for 60-year-olds, this is a program for 30-year-olds, and now we're a 20-year-old organization, and that's exactly what's being proposed here. It is confused thinking. And what's more, it's $150,000 worth of confused thinking. So let's have a much broader discussion about whether in fact there is a need for a logo and what's the intellectual foundation for that. Because as it is, we're just debating whether or not something looks pretty.
Members, can I just be very clear? This is what we are discussing tonight. This is the discussion on the broader requirement for this project to proceed or not. The devil in the detail in terms of what is to be executed, we have agreed there's going to be a workshop on. But members, this is the discussion that we are having tonight. Whether you speak for it or against it, this is the discussion. So I want everyone to be very clear on that. We're talking about the deferral. We have a mover and a seconder on a sustained motion. It's now had been amended by Councillor Moran. I just want you to be very clear on the process here. It's been seconded by Councillor Martin on a deferral. That's what we're talking about. Can I ask you to speak to the deferral and the deferral only? I've got now a Councillor Corbell I had. I think I've got Councillor Wilkinson. I've got Councillor Abiad, Lord Mayor, and Deputy Lord Mayor, is that right? We're talking to the deferral.
I've got a question. Is this a deferral to have a workshop to discuss and explore some ideas around a brand in more detail? Because if we're looking at the substantive, I don't actually agree with aligning with the state and say brand, and I don't agree with having three. I think we need to narrow it down. We need to have maximum of two. And I would like to explore this more in a workshop. So if it's a deferral to go to a workshop,
that's what I mean.
Then I'll support the deferral.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you. I'll speak in favour of deferral. I've spoken previously against us sort of having multiple brands. I think us having a brand saying Adelaide that's almost identical to the state thing is confusing, and the state government are doing that anyway. When there's a joint thing, their name's on it, our sponsorship and stuff like that's going to be confused with state government sponsorship, the same thing if our logo looks almost the same as the state government logo. So that's actually doing our sponsorship promotion a disservice by having a logo that looks like the state government logo. I think they'll do it on their own thing, and the ratepayers need to pay for that. So I think our most valuable logo is our coat of arms. That's our most the branding. Think of the Penfolds thing with the old-fashioned writing. That's the most recognisable aspect of that brand. Our coat of arms is our most identifiable logo. We should be getting the most mileage out of not going to some third thing that looks like a state government hand-me-down.
Councillor Abiad.
Look, I support the deferral to explore this further. And it's important to note, members, that look, with $160 odd million worth of budget, a marketing budget for this organisation should not be anything less than $4 to $5 million a year. We don't even spend close to that. So there is some things there that we need to do. Alignment of logos, I have a massive issue, and this is something that I hope we get to bring up in the workshop, of separating the administration and the corporation from the actual body. We are all the City of Adelaide. This is who we are. There's always the us against them mentality, us and council and elected body. And I mean, it needs to be important that as a team, we are appearing as to be united under the banner of the City of Adelaide. This is who we should be, not the Adelaide City Council specifically, because we are the City of Adelaide. And look, I agree with Councillor Wilkinson. We need to, if we head down the line of our own brand, we need to have our own branding, you know, for us to basically use the state branding with an Adelaide City Council under it or Adelaide under it. It does get a bit confusing to most people. Melbourne haven't gone that path. They've all got their individual approach to how they market their city. And I think it's something we need to consider. It will come at a cost, so please be aware of that. And it's something that we need to adopt a move with. And just in support of what Councillor Moran said earlier, we were not consulted as an elected body on the South Australian logo at all. So council did oppose at the time, to some degree a majority. The council elected body politically were not involved in the process. Some administration members were, and we were also not invited to the launch of the brand. So, you know, the state government did make a point of not including the state and not including the Adelaide City Council in the design of the logo for the state and for the City of Adelaide. And that is concerning, and I agree. I just wanted to put that on the record for Councillor Moran, because that definitely did happen at a time. Some of us took a liking to it possibly later, and they saw common sense in it, and et cetera, but that was the issue at the time. Political body of council was not consulted and were not invited to the launch at all. So I think that needs to be on record. But look, I look forward to the workshop, happy to support the deferral, but we just need to be mindful that we need to spend money if we want to do this properly.
Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. Question through the CEO, please. Should we defer this to a workshop, CEO? When would that be likely to happen, and what impact would that have in terms of our, and I'll finish where I started, 2016-2017 budget cycle? Because, Chair, I do not want to see this slip beyond the 16-17 budget cycle. So timing to me is everything on this. I think this is important that we work as a group of elected members to reach a consensus, and we adopt it and we put it into our 16-17 budget. Because I note in the report, and I'm not advocating for this, but I do note in the report the City of Sydney has 5 brands. I know the City of Melbourne has 4. City of Brisbane has 3. Not unprecedented, I'm not suggesting we do that, but we obviously need to spend time together working through all the permutations. This, I don't want it to go beyond the reach of the 16-17 budget cycle. CEO, what do we do?
Listen to the vote.
Through the chair, I understand there is a provision within the budget for the rebranding. That is as we currently have within the budget documents. We would anticipate undertaking a workshop fairly soon, given the level of this discussion. So within a couple of weeks, I would hope, if we can schedule it, that will enable it to still be continued within the budget, and that will enable us to roll with it if it needs to be.
Okay, on that basis, I'll support the amendment.
Any other speakers on the deferral? Councillor Moran, do you want to sum up?
Yes. I think the point that I've already taken out of this debate is the one that Sandy made, that if we put the state brand on projects that we think are a state or national importance, the average punter will just think it's the state. So if we're going to put a third one, it would have to be our own iconic special one. And then why wouldn't you want to replace the, not the Woolstack, obviously, the other one. But I think we have a perfectly, perhaps we should go through what the A with the dots actually was supposed to symbolise. We agonised over that. We spent a fortune. It's the River Murray, no, River Torrens with the seven tribes or something. It had a lot of thought go into it. Now, I don't think anybody here would remember what it meant and the hurdles we had to jump over to get that. It's not something just to be put aside lightly, and I think that does the job of this brand. But I think the really important thing is that you don't want to get mixed up. Why should the state government take credit for some of the things we're going to do? Because I can assure you, people will think it's the state government. So I don't want another brand. I think two are quite adequate. And if we do go to a third brand, we do it properly, and we have something that's quite separate from the state.
Picking up on that point, Councillor Moran, I can't see why we can't use them in tandem, even together. But anyway, let's put that in the workshop, I guess. Okay, that's summed up. This is to the deferral members. All those in favour? All those against? Declare that carried, so we will defer to a workshop. Thank you. That becomes a substantive. Councillor Slam, would you like to sum up?
Summed up.
I'll put that, members. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Right, and now move to item number 11, Deputy Lord Mayor.
Yes, just give me a moment, my iPad's got around to a fault and I've got to find it.
Technology has failed you.
It has, or I've
failed. Are you moving as Bridget, or do you have an amendment?
I have an amendment.
You have a new motion to present?
No, it's just amending paragraph 4.
So that's a new, yeah. So 1, 2 and 3 as printed?
As printed. And 4.
And 4.
Raise with the state, comma, via the capital city.
State government, you mean?
State government, comma, via the capital city committee, comma. The need for legislative reform to streamline and simplify the temporary closure of roads to facilitate events.
Can I make it just make it raise the state government and how we do it? Might be multiple of avenues. It might be the Lord Mayor writing, it might be through capital city, it might be, rather than just being so definitive as to how it's done.
Including via the capital city committee. It's a point that I'm wanting to come in at the top, not the bottom.
Okay. Just you know how those agendas can get sometimes. But all right, do I have and you leaving the existing four? Are you making that?
No, it's removing.
Replacing that?
Replacing the existing four. So if I can get a seconder, I'll talk about
it. Councillor Bashaw is seconding that.
Okay, thank you. This was my original motion, and the idea of it was to try and find ways that we could simplify the closure of roads so that we could have more events, and the events that we have in the city could manage themselves more easily. So just to give you an example, under the current arrangements, if Ebenezer Place closes, it has to go through a road closure process, even though it closed last week and it closed the week before. And on each occasion, that closure has to be advertised in the advertiser, and the event organiser has to pay for the cost of that advertising in the advertiser where nobody reads it. Well, I'd be very surprised if anybody reads it. So we've got this complex process that is used over and over again in some cases in relation to the same roads. And on each occasion, it costs the event organiser money. We had Heather Crowell here talking from the Fringe saying one of the most significant things we could do to assist the Fringe is to simplify these sort of processes so that people could have these events without any dramas. So I really want to thank the administration for the work they've currently done. They've said they have they've revised the fee structure, and what they're suggesting to us is that the temporary road closures for community groups, the fees be diminished. And I think that's a fantastic thing and a big win for our community. And obviously corporates still need to pay, but if the City South Association wants to close a road, then they're not going to have to pay through the nose like they have been. So I think that's a great thing. That we'll amend our fees and charges to achieve that. But what I really want us to do is to make sure that the state, that we work with the state on this, and it's state legislation. And I think we've tried for a number of years to be working with our staff, talking to their staff, but I don't think we're getting cut through at that level. I think if we just have the conversation at a high level so that the ministers understand that this is a simple thing, easily fixed, but it does need ministerial direction to make it happen. They need to say to their staff, solve this for us. So that's why I'm wanting it to be raised with the state government at the highest level, asking them to have a look at this so that we can quickly solve what ought to be just a simple red tape problem. And I know they're committed to it, we're committed to it, and so that people can get on with doing this easily.
Thank you. Councillor Vishaw is the seconder. Is that your right? Councillor Moran?
Look, I'm cautious about this. Road closures are a serious thing. The street you named has residents on it. And I don't think it's too much to ask each event to separately. I don't know how you'd roll them in, say they're going to close it for this month and there'll be five events. So I won't support this change because, as I said, closing roads is a serious business, and if they want to have an event on a public road, then they should go through the necessary red tape. So unless proven that it's absolutely unbelievably expensive, it's frightening people away, it's arduous, I have not heard that in my travels. I don't think it's too much to put in the advertiser, and I do think people read the advertiser in case they're listening. And I think they should let a box, and people should have the chance to say whether they. No, no, he's sick. He's watching.
Hello, Kelton.
So no, I don't support this. I don't agree with this thing that you cut all the red tape. Red tape is there for good reasons. That's that the people that use that road live on that road to have a say in whether their road's closed.
Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Can I just note that I've got new glasses and I can actually read all that? This is like a new world for me. I can see you all.
Fabulous.
Well, it's
really great.
Look, I will support this motion because I think the intention is a proper intention. That is, there will be good outcomes. I share the concerns about making sure that residents still have access to forewarning about road closures. But there are two things within the paper that I would like noted. And the first is that I don't think that the experience and certainly the estimates of the cost should completely rule out the use of bollards. And indeed, Ebenezer Place is a site that I would have thought would be ideal for bollards rather than this continual process of closing the road. Now, I have been down there, I've spoken with the organizer, Matt, I watched it happen, but even with a refined, streamlined process, there are considerable costs, and they deter event organizers. And the second thing is, I would ask for some refinement in the approach to corporate identities. The example that's mentioned in here of the News Limited event, City to Surf or Surf to City, corporate entities do, on occasions, hold events which have outcomes that are designed to benefit charities. And I think the distinction should not be between whether it's a community organisation or a corporate organisation or a corporate entity, but rather what the outcome is. And if that outcome it results in some good or benefit for the community, then that is what we ought to support. But aside from that, I will support this.
Can that be taken on notice, or is that comment can be taken on notice? Okay. Lord Mayor?
I'll support this, including the addition of point four, and that may amount to something, it may amount to nothing, we'll see. It's really it's an inclusion to investigate, isn't it? So, but further to Councillor Martin's points, I'd kind of hope that can be taken on notice, because it's I think maybe the delineation is for profit or not for profit, which is maybe an extrapolation of what the Councillor is saying. So I think it's quite a reasonable suggestion. Thanks, Chair.
Deputy Lord Mayor, to sum up.
Just briefly, thank the councillors for their comments. I think they're really useful comments, and I wanted to reassure Councillor Moran. By moving this amendment, it's not the intention is not to take away the rights of local residents. And I think there are simpler, better ways of informing them of road closures, signs in the location, for example. Phone numbers to ring if they've got some issues about it. Much cheaper for the person who's running the event, probably more effective for the people who live nearby it. So I'm not suggesting that we ride roughshod over the rights of residents. I'm just trying to make it easier so that these streets can be activated quickly, easily, cheaply, and our city can get the benefits that come from that.
Members, I'll put that, all those in favour. Where that carried. All those against. Members, do I have any other business? That being done, I'll now ask for a mover to exclude the public for item number 17, which is an out of session tonight. Councillor Corbell moved, seconded by Lord Mayor. Thank you. Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. I'll now ask anyone who is not associated with this item to please remove themselves. We might want to close the door after people have left. That would be useful. public? Thank you, members. We are now closed the meeting. Thank you. Members, I reconvene the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee, starting with item one, acknowledgement of country. The Infrastructure and Public Space Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains, pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people today. Apologies. A leave of absence on leave, Councillor Clarahan. Confirmation of minutes of a mover. Councillor Abiyad, seconded Councillor Moran. All those in favour? Those opposed? It's carried. Public forum. We have no items in public forum. Chair's verbal report. No report to make. Items for adoption on the block. Now, we have a presentation from the item seven, the Adelaide Town Hall Functions and Carpet Renewal. The speaker is ready, so I'll pull that one out. Item eight, Transport and Water Infrastructure Asset Management Plans. Councillor Antic. Item nine, Linear Park Trail Bank Stability Works. No one's called that up. Item 10, Victoria Square, Tardanyanga Access and Inclusion Improvements. Item 11, under Capital Works Program, South Parklands Creek Rehabilitation.
Oh, goodness.
What a victory. Okay, so I will now ask for a motion for items 9, 10 and 11. A mover for those on block. Councillor Abiyad, Councillor Martin second. If I put the motion for those items on block, all those in favour? All those opposed? That's carried. That brings us back to item 8. Item 7. Adelaide Town Hall Function Centre Carpet Renewal Stage 2, Andrew Klenke, Associate Director of Swan Group Hanglaze Architects, to present. Far away.
Thank you, Chairman. This is Stage 2 of the Function Centre Carpet Designs. Just wanted to quickly run through. This is following on from the work that occurred over Christmas last year, with the installation of the first floor foyer carpet. Stage two involves the second floor foyers, as well as the function rooms associated with the David Spence in the green room, as also as well as the banqueting room. Slide to give you an idea of what's there at present. Basically, it's the same carpet that was actually located in the foyer on the first floor. The image is somewhat difficult to see here, but basically the idea with the second floor carpet is to continue the theme with that, what happened on the first floor. So effectively, the carpet design for the southern foyers involves highlighted stripes that actually relate to the pilasters of the external wall of the building. And you can see those running through to where the circular columns are. So that's basically a continuation of the carpet design that's on the floor below. The colouring is exactly the same as the other foyer as well. The similar treatment has also been used at the top of the staircase, the main stair leading up to the dress circle, where we've got basically two highlight stripes running off the centre of those stair flights. And then equally a similar treatment to what actually has occurred in the Prince Alfred room is occurring within the two smaller meeting rooms, where we basically have a highlight strip running down the middle of those. So we can go to the next slide. It's just a detail of that design, basically the same design that occurs in the northern and the southern foyer of the first floor. If we can just go to the next one. Sorry, I don't actually have any complete photographs of it, so this is as they were installing the carpet, but it gives you an idea. The carpet down there is actually for the banqueting room, so. we don't actually have a sample of this because basically it's the same as what's happening down there. So these are just some shots to give you an idea. So similar treatment there, the idea of the blue panel will occur in the foyer of the David Spence room as it occurs in the Prince Alfred room here. So you notice that sort of central stripe running down the middle for the Prince Alfred room. In regards to the banqueting room, which is the next slide, I know it does look like a tennis court, but I think when I took that photograph, there were children doing some performance and they were all set out in lines and, you know, while they were waiting in here. So I apologise for that. But so the banqueting room is, you know, a magnificent space, one of the original spaces of the room. You can see the quite strong colouring, which is based on the current paint scheme is based on the 1897 paint decoration that was carried out at that time. A lot of pinks, particularly up in the ceiling, and but there's also greens and greys and throughout the paintwork. So that basically that was the theme that we've used for the colouring of the current carpet. The proposal is to use basically a design. If you look up in the top left corner, that's actually a cast iron screen that's dated from 1884, designed by Lockwood DeForest, who was one of the leaders of the aesthetic movement, an American. So it's almost totally contemporary with the the construction of that particular room. And it's continuing the principle of what we've been doing basically with the foyer carpet, which is basically a two-dimensional classical based pattern. What we've tried to use here is the circular motifs that are in the ceiling of the space as one of the characteristics. It's difficult to see with the sample that you've got here because the pattern is very large that we're looking at using, but hopefully the plan there gives you an idea of the scale of it. So the idea is basically a mixture of pinks, greens, greys with a dark grey background.
Sorry.
If we go to the next slide.
Apology accepted.
Also, one of the nice things with the, if we go back to the previous slide, one of the other reasons why we've also looked at using the circular motif is to pick up the curved corners of that particular room. And as you can see, the way it finishes in the corners is quite nice. If you go to the next one, this is just some details indicating the colours. This is not the final trial that we actually have in front of us. There is some slight modification going on. And then if we go to the next one, gives you an idea that that's the flood fill of the entire first floor, the way the banqueting room actually sits in with the rest of the carpet design that's already taken place. Hopefully that explains the principles. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. To any questions, Councillor Moran.
I assume this is made of pure 100% merino wool from Australia.
No, Councillor. It's the same, exactly the same principles as the foyer carpet.
Which changes my mind. Which is what that was, Australian. How can we not have a wool carpet in the city of Adelaide when we are the biggest wool producer of the finest wool in the world and we haven't picked Australian wool? There's at least an Australian carpet maker.
Councillor, there actually is no manufacturer of Axminster carpet in Australia, which is the carpet that we're using here, which is a commercial grade and allows us to do this sort of design work that we're talking about doing, what the proposal is. The other thing is the work in terms of the background work that we did in terms of the wool supply. Australia produces a very small percentage of the flock, very, very small. I can't remember the exact amount, it's less than 1% of the wool clip is actually the coarse wool, because carpet has to be made of the coarsest wool that you can actually get.
So
we don't produce that sort of really coarse wool. So.
Yeah, is it? Oh, okay.
We're off the top line, you know.
Any other questions, members?
Beautiful.
Okay. Thank you very much, Andrew. You good work.
Yeah.
Presentation. Okay, so we have the recommendation before us. Do we have a mover? Councillor Hender and Councillor Cobell to second. Councillor Hender, would you like to speak to the motion? And seconding Councillor Cobell?
Just as beautiful.
Councillor Martin?
Yes, I have a question for the administration. In looking at the documents, there's a figure of $401,000 mentioned in respect of, I think, 1516, which is stage one, and $60,000 is proposed coming out of our surplus into next year as a part of the 16-17 financial work which this falls into, but I couldn't find any cost for the balance of the work. Is the administration able to tell me what the difference is between the 60,000 and the actual cost?
Through you, Presiding Member, just as Mr. Burton is actually just giving the cost now, so we'll let you just refer with it 1 second.
Through the chair, just in response to the question, the 401 is the total project budget, and of that, 60,000 will be carried forward.
So we've already spent $341,000.
Through the chair, we haven't spent 340 at this stage. We have a contract in place. We have a commitment in place. We will spend a portion of, well, we were hoping to spend 340 by the end of the financial year, essentially, requiring a $60,000 carry forward. So we have the order for this carpet that we will finance, obviously, and pay an invoice on. And essentially what's remaining, which is the carpet to the gallery area in the auditorium and some carpet in the lower auditorium area will be the balance of the contract for that. So the 60,000 would be for that work.
Okay, and how much has been expended already? Aside from this?
I couldn't give you an exact figure, but essentially forward, it'd be about $250,000 to $260,000 to date.
Okay, thank you. Chair, look, I won't be voting to support this. I didn't support it on the first occasion. I went on this occasion. I think it's a large expenditure. and too great for our ratepayers who will bear the burden of this.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Any further questions, comments? Okay, to sum up.
Look, I acknowledge Councillor Martin's concerns about the expense of it, but I do. I look on this as our 175th birthday present to our city. That we haven't really done anything else to mark that significant milestone inside our town hall. I think the changes that we're making, and we're making them incrementally, are changes that will stand us in very good stead. This is a beautiful heritage building. We don't spend a whole lot of dough on it. Have a bit of a look around. It's not something we... and this is our chance to actually incrementally get it right. And I'm proud of the work that we're doing here, and I think I really commend this, particularly. I'm particularly fond of that, I have to say. So I think this is our gift to our city, to our beautiful heritage town hall. And I think it's money, while it's expensive, I acknowledge it's expensive, I think it's money well spent.
Okay, I put that motion. All those in favour? All those opposed? Carry. Thank you. Okay, so now for item 8, we've got a facilitator, Madeline Bickerbeck, Team Leader of Infrastructure Assets. Welcome, Madeline. Councillor Ant has called out this item.
Sorry, technical difficulty. Okay, so council exists to deliver services to the community, and asset management is about how we deliver those services to meet the needs of the community in the most cost-effective way over the life of the asset. And good asset management will help us deliver the city's vision of being a smart, green, livable boutique city full of rich experiences. So today we want to talk to you about the two asset management plans, the transportation and water infrastructure asset management plans, which I'm sure you've all read. Back in May last year, we brought all six asset management plans in their draft format to council, as well as the summary pages. And we then proceeded with public consultation on the service levels of those assets in November last year to January this year. And now we've updated the plans with information from the public consultation, as well as some of the key themes and actions out of the draft strategic plan. And we're asking for your endorsement to proceed with final consultation on the asset management plans. So today we've got these two. Next month we'll be bringing you buildings and parklands, month after urban elements and lighting and electrical. And then finally we'll undertake community consultation on all six plans in August. We will then update the plans as required, and then we will submit the final asset management plans to council for adoption in October 2016. The reason we have October up there is because it's a legislative requirement to adopt asset management plans within 2 years of a new council. So, giving you a quick background of the asset management journey that we've been on. In 2012, we undertook an asset management maturity assessment. Essentially, what you need to know on that spider diagram is that green is advanced asset management, red is core asset management, and blue is where we, Adelaide City Council, sat back in 2012. So there are a number of areas where we could improve, and we set about undertaking a number of tasks, and I'll talk through them on the next slide, to get to the point where in 2014 we reassessed where we were at in terms of our asset management capabilities and practices and procedures. And we met or exceeded 9 of the 11 core targets, which is a great result. But understanding that it's a journey, and we'll continually be on this asset management journey, and we want to be a best practice organisation, so it's something that we continually want to improve on. Some of the things that we've done to improve our asset management data and capabilities, we've undertaken data collection and condition auditing, which helps us understand what we have, where it is, what condition it's in, and what it's worth. We've implemented a maintenance management system called RAM. This helps remove duplication, provides efficiencies, and helps build our asset management histories. We undertook asset revaluations to understand what financial position we were in. We developed a UniRate library to provide standardized and efficient estimating. We started updating our asset management plans, which we've now brought for you tonight. We updated the asset management policy, and we started updating the asset accounting policy to ensure that we comply with the standards. So a quick snapshot, and don't need to look at the detail on this one, of what we can provide in terms of asset information. This one's urban element assets. And essentially, at the click of a button, you can figure out what we have, where it is, what it's worth, what condition it's in. You can map it. The guys out on the road can have a tablet format and see exactly what they need to do for the day and then tick off what has and hasn't been done. I won't go into too much detail because that's a complex slide. So the reason that we need asset management plans, not only are they a legislative requirement, but they also ensure that we're managing the assets in a financially sustainable manner that provides the best value to the community. They detail out the actions that are required to provide the agreed level of service for our assets. They also provide the linkage between the strategic plan and the long-term financial plan, and they're one of Council's three key strategic documents. We want to reiterate that these documents are live documents. They're not going on the shelf, even though we're asking for your endorsement to proceed with final consultation. We do want to update them annually. And in current format, they're based on 14-15 data because that was the best available data at the time. But when, as soon as we collect new data, we will be revising them and updating them. And similarly, at the time, the strategic plan was in draft format. So I think it's section 3.2. You've probably seen that we've detailed at a high level what the opportunities are in terms of incorporating the strategic plan targets, but we need to do further work on this once that's adopted, and that's why we want them to be live documents continually being updated. So as I said, we have six asset management plans, but we want to give you two at a time, not to bombard you. So tonight we're going to talk about transportation and water infrastructure asset management plans. The transportation asset portfolio is the biggest asset portfolio that Council owns. It's worth $660 million, and it's comprised of roads, footpaths, curbs, bridges, and traffic signals.
I can't even sell it.
You might be able to sell signals, though. This slide shows the condition and the community feedback that we've received around that condition. So the pie charts essentially show you what condition the asset's in from a basic, very good, good, average, poor, and very poor rating. So roads are not too bad, footpaths are okay, curb and water table looks great from that because, you know, more than 50% is in a very good condition. And again, some of this was reiterated through the feedback that we received from the community. So they said that the streets are easy to get around, the roads are well maintained. In terms of the maintenance of the roads and footpaths, they rated us at 7 and 7.1 out of 10, which if you compare it to the SA local government targets, they have a target of 7. So that's great, we meet the target, we slightly exceed it for footpaths. We also got some feedback that footpaths are generally in good condition, but key laneways, and especially the market to rail link was brought up, could have some improvements undertaken on them. So that's something, that feedback goes back into the plan, and that's how we reanalyze and prioritize our programs.
Can I just ask a question from the chair? You mentioned about laneways. The city has numerous rights of ways, and that's always a grey land in terms of who's responsible. What are our plans in terms of that maintaining those, or are they omitted from this document?
Through you, Chair, no, they're not omitted. What we're looking at is all assets owned by council, public realm. So the reality is if we have an interface and it butts up to a private laneway or any sort of laneway and we're responsible for it, it will be part of an assessment. And we're actually working through some laneways as we speak, that understanding who owns it and where we actually interact with it. So we have a responsibility to make good, and it's been part of the assessment as well.
Useful to have a map showing all the laneways that are not council owned. So that's
through you, Chair, I can give you an undertaking subject to bringing that information, but we certainly can provide you with that information.
Thank you.
Thank you. So the key actions that we want to highlight that have come out of this transportation asset management plan. Essentially, all transportation assets except for roads, we want to renew all poor and very poor condition assets within 5 years. So if you go back to the pie charts, ignoring the first one for roads, but the other four, imagine there's no orange or red within 5 years. That's our target. And for the roads, because they're a much larger asset and worth a lot more, we are proposing that we will reduce the percentage of poor and very poor condition roads from 33% to 4% over the 10 years. Now, onto the expenditure. So, sorry, do you want me to go back?
No, it's all right.
Okay. So the blue is what has come out of the asset management plan. It tells us how much money we need to renew, maintain, and operate all transportation assets over the next 10 years to make sure that we're providing the desired level of service to the community. Ignoring the black line, because that's not relevant to this, the red is essentially what the long-term financial plan shows we have in the budget. But with the transportation asset, so obviously there's a huge gap over the 10 years, but we came back to council in February this year and we presented this shortfall, and thankfully it was agreed that you will fund the shortfall for transportation assets. So now it looks like that. So the red and blue match. So essentially we have enough money in a long-term financial plan to maintain the assets to the level of service that the community wants, which is a great result. That's what we're aiming for in our asset management plans. Some of the risks that we highlighted in the plan are around increased public transport on our network. We don't know all the impacts of what that's going to have on our network and whether there's increased operating or maintenance requirements. The full impacts of the potentially different and new service standards out of the Adelaide Design Manual haven't been explored properly. And also, as I said before, the strategic plan, because it was still in draft format, we haven't explored it in detail. So that's a lot of analysis that needs to happen before the next revision of the plan. And we also highlighted the risk of all the increased city visitors. We're not 100% sure of what the impacts are on maintenance and operating costs of all our footpaths. So that's some more analysis that needs to happen over the next 12 months. In terms of opportunities, we've identified through planning our maintenance rather than just reacting, we can now better meet community needs faster and also more cost effectively. By combining renewals and enhancements, we can create delivery and project delivery efficiencies. And also, now that we have this future plan, we know what we're going to do over the next 5, 10 years. We can talk to state government about getting external funding, or we can look at utility companies sharing our plans and saying, this is what we're doing for the next few years. Can you tell us what you're doing so that we can plan and coordinate better together? The Water Infrastructure Asset Management Plan, I'll give you, I guess, the same background as for the transport assets. There are three parts to the Water Infrastructure Plan. There's Stormwater Drainage Network, which is underground, River Torrens, and the watercourse assets, and there's also environmental and wastewater infrastructure. These assets are worth $127 million. So this, again, is the condition and community feedback. Now the stormwater drainage network, over 80% of the network is in average to very good condition. And bearing in mind the stormwater network can last, these are very long-lived assets, so these can last for up to 100 years, some of our pipes. So we don't tend to need to spend a lot on that because that will stay like that for a while. The Torrens and watercourse, obviously there's a bit of room for improvement on that asset class because a lot of it, over 50%, is in poor condition. And the environmental and wastewater, whilst it does look like it's in good and very good condition, total opposite to stormwater drainage, these are short to medium term assets, so they do need to be renewed regularly or more regularly than the stormwater assets. The feedback we received from the community, this is a tough one to get feedback from, but in general it was quite good. So they talked about rainfall events, when it rains normally in a minor, what we'd call a minor event. We found that people were fine accessing footpaths, roads and cycle paths. But in terms of a major rainfall event, not enough respondents experienced it to be able to tell us whether they thought properties and people would be protected from a significant rain event. In terms of the Torrens Lake and Parklands, we got feedback that the maintenance of those watercourses was rated 7.6 out of 10, which is great, highly above the 7.0, which is what we're aiming for. But we did receive some feedback that the Torrens was considered dirty and needs some environmental improvement. So the key actions we want to undertake in this asset management plan, as I said, we're not really touching much of the stormwater network because that will stay as it is for decades to come. The Torrens and watercourse assets, we're renewing more than 3 kilometres of watercourses and open channel drains. We plan to renew several boat landings and earth retaining structures in the Torrens. And we also want to install 2 temporary water storages in parks 16 and 20 associated with Brown Hill Keswick Creek. The environmental wastewater assets, we want to construct a new wetland in Vic Park and also install water-sensitive urban design facilities around the city. We also want to look at putting in 3 new gross pollutant traps in North Adelaide and the South Parklands. So on this one, in terms of blue being what the asset management plan says we require over the next 10 years, compared to the red, which is the long-term financial plan, the first few years is fine, it matches. But then you'll notice, especially in the last 5 years, the gap tends to increase. And the reason for that is because those new assets, like the wetlands, the gross pollutant traps, and the water-sensitive urban design facilities, they're coming on board, and we don't have enough funding to maintain and operate those facilities. So we've thought about this, and we've highlighted them as risks. And the way we plan to maintain these, or to manage these risks, sorry, is looking at, during the feasibility and design of the Vic Park wetlands, we want to look at ways to minimise operational and maintenance costs. We also want to look at if there's more cost-effective ways to provide the services like gross pollutant traps and water-sensitive urban design facilities. So we do have a few years to do some of that work and analysis to make sure that we're not creating a funding gap in future. Another risk we highlighted was the unknown condition of essentially what's under the surface of the Torrens. So to mitigate that risk, we need to undertake an underwater condition assessment and look at the impacts of that and whether work out what the remaining useful life of those assets are and whether we need to put that into the long-term financial plan. The opportunities we identified include incorporating greening and sustainability initiatives through improving the environmental wastewater infrastructure, which are key strategic plan targets, and also continuing partnerships with state government bodies, industry and the community, so that we can develop sustainability and water quality management strategies for our water assets. So just to reiterate, tonight what we're asking for is endorsement of these two plans, the transportation and water infrastructure asset management plans, so that we can proceed with final consultation, hopefully aiming for August, and then submit them back to you in October for final adoption.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Councillor Maloney.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to ask about the Torrens. I mean, it's all good and I'm an expert in a lot of these areas, but using the Torrens example, but particularly, you know, Torrens, we talk about, we have this ambition to improve the quality of the river and the use of the river. And I guess there's sort of level 1, level 2, level 3 where you get it. I mean, where are we actually aiming for? If I was to say it was ultimately something, you said the consultation said that the Torrens, you know, to the people that responded, looks a bit dirty and etc. If I was to say get it to the level where people walk past and go, well, that is an amazing river, versus where it is now, versus where we're talking about to be on this plan. Can you give me indicatively where we're aiming for?
Through Chair. Yes, I guess in regards to that, we're looking at the current service level that we provide. So there's a number of activities that happen on the Torrens currently, informal recreation, the boating, the Popeye, that sort of stuff. And I think it's important that we sustain that and try not to have a break in service for those operators, so that businesses can continue to run and the natural recreational opportunity that it provides is maintained. So trying to minimise any shutdown periods of the Torrens. and try and minimise our maintenance costs in regards to that. So we know that at the current point in time, we sometimes get outbreaks of blue-green algae on the lake, and trying to deal with and treat those outbreaks is costly. So it's about putting preventative schemes in place to minimise those occurrences and minimise the shutdown. I guess on top of that, the strategic plan talks, I think, about the objective of having great recreation in and around the Torrens. And I think with the intent of one day swimming in the Torrens, I think it was mentioned at one point. And I guess to try and achieve that level of service out of the Torrens would be a big step up. And that's not what the plan's currently addressing. We're really saying, how do we address the current use of the Torrens and trying to maintain uptime and recreation use of the Torrens in its current form.
So just on that, correct me if I'm wrong, because I think what you described as the minimum, I think we would all agree is bare minimum to get to that next level. Are you saying this isn't the plan of which it should be addressed, or ultimately this is the plan where that should be addressed?
Yeah, through Chair, I think it is the plan where it should be addressed. I guess a clear strategic direction as to where the Torrens needs to be, whether that's a meeting a community need or a desire of the council through the strategic plan, would set that target, and we can certainly respond to that through this plan to say what management or maintenance practices we need to put in place in partnership with the NRM, SA Water, Junior and other state associations to say, how do we bring this Torrens back up to a level where we can achieve those objectives defined through the strategic plan. We would do the work to determine what that is, determine the cost associated with doing that, and then that would be reflected back in council's long-term financial plan and your budgets.
And, you know, I see, because we've got our strategic plan, and I know this is for consultation, and we've got our strategic plan, then we have our business plan and budget, and then we have all the plans that sit underneath that, of which this is one of them. And I'm seeing a disalignment, is that a word? I'm not seeing an alignment between what our strategic plan is looking to achieve and what operationally we're looking to achieve. That's just some feedback. I think it might be the same feedback for the roads as well, that we might have the same. I'm just not seeing that alignment.
Malani, I think Mr. McCready might be able to assist you then.
So through you, Chair, and to support Phil's comments, the asset management plan talks to maintaining or renewing the asset, but in particular in regards to water course, it talks about quality as well, and we can't get away from that. So some of the pieces of work that we'll work with, as Phil's indicated, is working with the NRM board, who ultimately have responsibility for that water course. One of the main ones that we really need to work with is upstream councils, because that naturally impacts in regards to us downstream. So we need to work with the upstream councils in regards to enhancing what flows into the Torrens through stormwater, looking at gross pollutant traps, looking at all the ways to actually improve the actual quality of the water coming in. In saying that, 7.6 in regards to a survey for looking at the actual quality of the waterways is actually a very exceptional result. It hasn't been 7.6 in a long, or even 7 in a long, long time. And just to reiterate what Phil has indicated, blue-green algae, we have put in preventative measures. We've had environmental flows coming in. It'd be a challenge next year because I know that there's a lot less water up in the catchments, and actually the River Murray and also in Kangaroo Creek. That environmental flow has probably stopped blue-green algae for the past 2 years coming in. So the quality of the water is improving through good asset management practices and also the actions that we're undertaking.
And can I just ask a question? Because Tom, for example, you use those examples about what we must do in partnership with other councils. But shouldn't that then be in this plan? That I guess that's what I'm saying. That I'm not seeing the link to the aspiration and this plan. That's all I'm saying.
The CEO would just like to.
Yeah, through the chair, just to clarify, there are a series of strategic management plans that we have. And the intent will be over the next 12 months to review the alignment of all those plans to see that they do link together. That is a piece of work that I will be intending to do. There is a slight disconnect. The plans are effective as individual plans. Mm-hmm. We do need to be sure there's good alignment, so we'll be doing that.
Deputy Lord Mayor Hendo.
I wanted to start by saying congratulations for the work that you've been doing so far in bringing our asset management up to speed. And that graph, the spiderweb graph, is very telling, and I think that's really great work. And I also wanted to thank you, Madeline, for your presentation, because I read these papers, but it just, you speaking us through, talking us through it was really, really illuminated it for me, and so I much better understand what we're trying to achieve. But I do have a couple of questions. One of them relates, and I think I know the answer, but I just, and maybe it's something the CEO just said, it's about the Adelaide Design Manual. Like, you know, we're saying here in the first one of these plans that we're not taking it into account yet, but I just wanted to understand how that will get taken into account, because it is one of our aspirations, and I do want to see how it's going to play into these documents. First question, if you can answer that, and then I have another.
Through the chair, as I said, we haven't taken into account in detail some of the draft strategic plan actions and as well as the Adelaide Design Manual, because we're currently piloting and testing some of those materials in the ADM. And the full implications of the ongoing costs and maintenance and operating and renewal components to those new materials hasn't been fully documented, and so we haven't been able to put it into the plans. But because we are saying that they are live documents and we do want to continually review them and update them, as soon as we get that information, we want to put that into the plan so that it does reflect all of Council's approved strategic documents.
Which sort of ties into my next question. These are going out for consultation. So we've already consulted, and obviously we've got some really good feedback on how we're perceived. What's the consultation seeking to achieve now? And then if we change the document, how does that impact on the consultant, you know, because it's a consultant on documents. So can you just talk me through a bit about what the consultation process does?
Yep, so through the chair, in November last year, what we consulted on was not the entire asset management plan, it was just the service levels. So what we need to do now is talk to the community about the entire asset management plan, and figure out whether they agree, disagree, whether they have suggestions or improvements to make. And in terms of updating it, it may or may not be possible to update them in that time. There may be bigger things that we need to do further analysis on, and financial analysis as well. And it does take a lot of time to update all the graphs and analysis in these documents. So it's not just a quick, you know, couple of weeks turnaround. Essentially, the community has seen our A3 summary pages, but they haven't seen the full document and the implications of what we intend to do. And what we want them to look at also is, you know, we have technical levels of service for the assets, but we also have community levels of service. So we want to make sure that we're producing or delivering services to the community that are at the level that they want, so that we're not over-servicing or under-servicing, and that gives them the opportunity to say to us, you know, we want additional X, Y, Z to make sure that you meet our community needs.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, look, actually, just to reiterate the Lord Mayor's comments about the value of the work and the amount of time that's gone into it, and just the way we're moving towards the asset renewals is terrific. I think that's really what we're all about. As we know, I think that's really what we're here for. But my concern is just that the amount of material that's in there, it's an enormous document, and I have read it, but I just haven't had an opportunity really to really let it sink in yet. So I'm concerned about voting on endorsing the entire document when I don't feel like I'm really over it. So what I was going to foreshadow was a referral to a workshop. We've sort of had that, but I'd just like some more time to look over the two.
Councillor Antic, we haven't got a motion yet.
Well, I was going
to be informal, so you're at liberty to move a motion.
Well, the motion was going to be simply that we, I think we've got time to do this, because we've still, in terms of the time frame, that matter be adjourned or deferred to a workshop in the coming. Well, it'll be adjourned for further. Be adjourned to a later. I can hear that. But,
if I can make a suggestion, because I have the same concern that I haven't had a chance to read through this in detail, and it's huge, and the presentation was fantastic. Yeah, thanks. But perhaps if before it goes to consultation, I guess what we're asking is for an amount of time that we can actually read through it and then feedback any comments before it goes to consultation. So if we can defer the consultation by a few weeks, will that have an impact?
It's not being sold until June.
We've proposed.
Through the chair, we've proposed that we undertake the consultation on all six plans in August, because we're bringing you two in May, two in June, two in July.
Oh, yeah.
And then the October deadline, there is a risk that we will miss final adoption of the plans in October, which is a legislative requirement.
So that being the case, then we have time to come back to you before it goes out to consultation. Alex, does that cover it?
Councillor Bashaw, we just through the chair, Mr McCready.
Through you, Chair. Firstly, we would be coming back to council in regards to the document for final review. The importance is to get a feel if there's any deal breakers in regards to the community, in regards to the asset management plan. But council will have its time to be able to fully review, knowing also this has to go to council in another week's time as well. But if you need more time, what I would be saying and recommending is that we go out to consultation with a draft plan and then come back to council in regards to a workshop in regards to what the community has said, because you have a more fuller picture.
Well, I hear all of that, but I'm concerned about the concept of endorsing the draft plan when I just don't, I'm not across the details still. One of the answers to this might be that we have a bit more time for the following. I know we've got a whole heap of them to get through, so it might be useful just to have that. I mean, it would have been an extra week or something. It's just a huge document, and it's just because so much work has gone into it. It's such a good piece of working document. So I just don't think I can endorse a document I'm not over at the moment. So I don't necessarily want another workshop. I just think I need more time. And I have read it. I just don't.
Can I make a suggestion?
Yes.
Can we perhaps maybe move that we carry this to the next infrastructure committee, to the next meeting you've got for final endorsement or et cetera that requires to be done? That would give Councillor Antic 4 weeks.
I'm a very slow reader.
Yep. So I'm happy to move in that.
Yeah, that's fine.
If you like.
Seconded.
The motion is to defer.
To the motion,
yes. It's very straightforward. We'll give opportunity to councillors to read the document in detail, make any necessary changes as required, recommend them accordingly directly to administration so they can feed through that process over the next 4 weeks. And then potentially at the following committee of infrastructure, we'll be able to take all that change on board or feedback on board and endorse the way moving forward.
Thank you. Councillor Abia, Councillor Antic, seconding that?
Second that, no.
So Councillor Martin, then Councillor Malani. And then Councillor Martin, then the Lord Mayor, sorry.
No, Lord Mayor? It's a motion to defer this for another month. I have nothing to contribute to.
Thanks, Chair. Just given that there is a number of these documents to follow, I'm just wondering, just in terms of setting the precedent, that if there's any way, CEO, these documents could be provided. It's reading time is the issue here. If there's any way for these subsequent documents, which will follow over the next few weeks, is there any way that they could be distributed to us either days earlier than what they otherwise would be?
Through you, presiding member, we'll give an undertaking to have a look at that, Lord Mayor, and give you ample time to review. From speaking to Phil, really for us, September is critical because we want to get out to consultation, but what we don't want to do is bombard the community with effectively six asset management plans. So that's why we're staging it, so that we can actually roll the consultation out. But we're happy to look at that and get the information out to you as full as possible.
Councillor Malone and Councillor Bashaw.
Well, the Lord Mayor's question was my question, but now I have a subsequent question, which probably is your question. My understanding was this was going out in August. It says simultaneously in August, and you're saying no, you want to stay there.
But through you, presiding member, what we're saying is we could extend the timeline to September, effectively to run out, so which will provide you with more time in regards to reading and coming back with any questions. So I'm trying to buy the 4 weeks.
I'm not sure that's answered the question either. So you're talking about staggering them from August. Is that correct? Taking them out from August, staggering them?
Mr. McCready?
Or that they're all going out at the same time, just giving them more time?
Through you, presiding member. The first part is to get the documents in front of you. So what we will do is provide you with ample reading time. What we were trying to do was to get the documents out during that consultation period in August and September. There's a large amount of documents. You've indicated how big they are to come back in October. So what we're saying is, effectively, we would still attempt to stage it where possible, but we'll have a look at the mechanism, how we actually get it out to the community.
Yeah. And to that end, given that presentation was really good and these plans are very dense, part of your consultation, are you going to be doing presentations for general public if they reply? Could that be considered, possibly?
Mr. McCready.
Through you, presiding member, I think it's a very good idea in regards to that, and also probably have them on the website and at our council libraries and so
forth. Really, okay, any further discussion? I'll put that back to Councillor Abiyad to sum up. I put that, all those in favour? All those opposed? Okay, thank you all. Thanks for your work on that. Item 14 on the agenda. Other business, the Lord Mayor motion on notice to propose Adelink Light Rail Network.
Thank you very much, Chair. The members, last Thursday week, you'd be aware that we...
Are you moving?
Yes, I am. I'll move as printed and I'll look for a second, then I'll speak to a chair. Thank you very much. Thanks, Chair. Apologies for that. Chair, last Thursday week, of course, we held a light rail summit here at Town Hall, and that was, and thank you to the councillors that attended, and thank you to Councillor Vershaw, MFC. Much appreciated. The objective of which was just build some consensus amongst inner metropolitan councils, including to just look at this opportunity around Adelink or reinstating to some degree a former light rail network that went through metropolitan Adelaide. And on that level, it was a success. But what we did, Chair, is we heard from the City of Sydney and the Gold Coast City Council, who are both undertaking quite large light rail projects currently. So we wanted to learn from their experience too. The effectively, what the output of that light rail forum was building unity amongst councils, but it was to ask the question, is light rail a key priority? It is, certainly that was the feedback that came back. Would we consider providing in principle support for Adelink and to take this back to respective councils for endorsement, which is what I'm asking here today. And also for each our council and for other councils to participate in Minister Mulligan's $4 million study around Adelink, which he really can't complete without the input of various councils, ours included, and to consider all the funding options. Notwithstanding, we all unanimously said we are not in favour of new taxes on our communities. So part of the output, Chair, was the motion which the members have before them now, which is the three-part motion, which each of the councils are taking back to their respective committees and chambers this week, next week, and the week after. And then what we will do is it will reconvene in coming weeks after that. So members, there's a three-part motion in front of you. I think this is in principle support at best. That's what I'm looking for. But it's, do we acknowledge that light rail has merit? Do we acknowledge that we will work with Minister Mulligan to feed into the Adelink report, or the study which he's working on? And do we acknowledge that we would look at the various funding options available to funding light rail without, of course, at this point in time, committing ourselves to one? So that's what the motion before you says, Chair.
A second, Deputy Lord Mayor. Any other comments or questions? To sum up, Lord Mayor?
Summed up, Chair.
I put that. All those in favour? All those opposed? That's carried. That brings us to other business. Do we have any other business? There being no other business, I close the meeting. 8:15. Thank you.